hanging on Calvary's cross, that in our humanity, we will have moments where we are hanging and hurting and helpless. And in those hanging and hurting and hopeless and helpless moments, those moments do not nullify imminent victory, but those moments actually qualify us for another level of victory and power. That's why now, sisters and brothers, I can thank God for the stuff that I could not thank him in. Because if I had not gone through that, then I would not be who I am. Come here, David. He said, it was good for me. I wish I had about 3 Bible readers. That I had been afflicted, that I might learn your statutes and your judgments. Somebody can be a witness to the fact that trouble made you better. Even though it was good for me, though it may not have been good to me, but so many of us spend so much time trying to pretend like we are okay, and we are not okay, because we have been wrongfully conditioned and programmed, even in church, to believe that a requirement of an overcomer and the requirement of a true worshiper is a false presentation of happiness when all hell is breaking loose in your life. And so they taught you that when saints die in the Lord, you shouldn't cry, because you know that they're in a better place. And if you cry and grieve over the people that you've grown attached to in the soulish realm, then you must not be a worshiper of God, because worshipers don't show their feelings. Don't you dare leave the doctor's office after receiving a negative report with any look of concern or discomfort on your face, or show any signs of anxiety or frustration, because that's not how worshipers act. You better not be down in the dumps after the relationship that you thought was your miracle on 34th Street turned out to be your nightmare on Elm Street. It broke your heart, and you better not be sad about it, because worshipers don't have feelings. Worshipers don't experience devastating days. They just praise and dance and shout their way through it, and after a while and by, everything will be all right. And if that's your approach to life and worship, I must admit at the beginning of the sermon that this is not the sermon for you, and that what God is about to do is he's going to make you a target, and he's not going to stop until he breaks you all the way down, because you have now exalted yourself to a place of divinity from which God must now dethrone you, because he created us to be able to feel, and we're living in a body and have a soul. Come here, Bible. Y'all not going to help me, and I'm going to preach it now. God is a spirit. Help me, preacher. And those that worship him must worship him how? In spirit and in truth. Truth, yeah. Truth and authenticity is a genuine requirement for worship. And watch this. In fact, sometimes it's in the moments of sincere worship that God actually reveals to us the true condition of who we are. Jesus is hanging on and arguably the most vulnerable moment of his life since he was born. And he does not try to pretend as if it does not hurt. He does not try to pretend as if the nails and the thorns and the lashes which pierce the very layers of his soul do not hurt. And if Jesus could hurt, what makes you and I think that we aren't going to go through some pain? Oh, Lord, just find somebody to come. Stop pretending. Stop pretending. There in just a second. You do understand, I can hoop at any time. It doesn't require an anointing, but you have to have something to hoop about. And so Jesus now is dying an excruciating death to save people who don't even want him. The same folk who were proclaiming Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, 7 days before, are now crying, crucify him, and demanding the release of a prisoner named Barabbas who received amnesty for crimes he willfully committed, when Jesus in his innocence is now forced not only to deal with the physical abuse, but watch this, Jesus is now dealing with the spiritual attachment of transgressions that did not belong to him. And you understand that theologically God in his holiness cannot behold sin. And so in order for Jesus now to serve as the ransom or the payment for sin, God could not rescue his only begotten son, Jesus Christ, from the gruesome agony of the cross. And so as we watch the text, when you read the text, the reality of Jesus' pain is that it resulted in what I believe is one of the strongest